Tonight, the UN Secretary General sets off on a peace mission to Baghdad. Angry relatives lash out at Taiwan's China Airlines. And the aftermath of World War II, British POWs fight for compensation. Good evening, Rosemary Church with Australia Television News. The UN Secretary General Kofi Annan is on his way to Baghdad. He stopped in Paris to brief French President Jacques Chirac on his mission. It's now widely acknowledged that Mr. Annan's trip to Iraq might be the last hope before war. Annan says he's reasonably confident he can get Iraq to comply with those UN resolutions which require Saddam Hussein to get rid of his most dangerous weapons and let UN weapons inspectors back in. The big question, is this enough to satisfy the United States?
No higher authority than the president himself made it clear today that Kofi Annan's Baghdad visit is a make-or-break event.
We hope the Secretary General's mission will succeed. But let me be clear, if diplomacy fails, we must be, and we are, prepared to act. The choice is Saddam Hussein's.
To drive home the point, Mr. Clinton said the vice president is postponing a trip abroad because he wants his full national security team on hand for decisions. In Baghdad today, there was no apparent softening.
The United States...
But rather, Iraqi television highlighted the booing of U.S. cabinet officers at yesterday's Columbus, Ohio town meeting. And what does the president think of what happened yesterday in Ohio?
Well, I thought it was a good old-fashioned American debate. I believe strongly that most Americans support our policy. They support our resolve.
The debate continued today with Secretary of State Albright speaking first at Tennessee State University, then at the University of South Carolina. But the old-fashioned was missing this time. Attendance was tightly controlled, and there was no booing.
I really feel good about being on a university campus today.
With or without hecklers, the public debate at this point is unlikely to change the president's course. If the Secretary General returns with an acceptable deal, well and good. If he gets stiff, the president addresses the nation and action follows. The more difficult problem would be if Saddam gives just enough to make it appear unreasonable not to negotiate further.
If the United States does decide to attack Iraq, the military faces what Pentagon officials call a planning nightmare. As of tonight, three of America's allies in the Middle East will not allow the United States to take off from there to attack Iraq.
With the last reinforcement of American warplanes now in Kuwait, the United States has roughly 250 attack aircraft in the region. But nearly half of that force could be grounded. 50 of these planes are in Saudi Arabia, 35 in Bahrain, and 30 in Turkey. Saudi Arabia and Turkey, U.S. allies, have already told Washington that American bombers cannot take off from their territory to hit Iraq. Another ally, Bahrain, has been wavering. Even worse, Saudi Arabia may not allow any support planes to fly from its territory either. Tankers, AWACS radar aircraft, and U-2 spy planes. It's a possible showstopper, according to one official. In public, the Pentagon is maintaining a posture of optimism, hoping that when the time comes, Saudi Arabia and Bahrain in particular will be there. If they are not, it could have a drastic impact on the type of targets the U.S. is able to hit and how hard.
Meanwhile, Australian SAS troops have arrived in Kuwait. They're now preparing for a highly dangerous mission supporting possible military action against Iraq. While any attack would almost certainly be from the air, Australian ground troops could be called on to mount search and rescue operations. Our correspondent Ben Wilson reports from Kuwait.
Under the cover of darkness, the RAAF jet bearing Australia's most elite fighting unit touched down in the Persian Gulf. The arrival of the 110-strong force delayed nearly 36 hours after a logistical hitch left the men stranded on the Indian Ocean base of Diego Garcia. So sensitive is the nature of the Australian deployment, the identities of these soldiers cannot be revealed to protect operational security. On the tarmac to greet the incoming force, top-ranking Kuwaiti military officers and Australian diplomatic staff. These men will serve under United States command, providing crucial intelligence and support for US air crews operating over Iraq should this crisis escalate into war. In the event of a military strike against Iraq, the 110 commandos based in Kuwait will be tasked some of the most hazardous assignments, including reconnaissance over Iraqi territory and the retrieval of any pilots who may be shot down. Although its contribution to the military build-up is small in number, government officials say it's no measure of Australia's commitment to the task.
The troops that have arrived here tonight in Kuwait to ensure that the UN sanctions are fully applied and that our being here is a sign of our preparedness to support the fulfilment of those sanctions.
The commando team has now been moved to a secret base where they'll begin immediate preparations should last-ditch diplomacy this weekend fail to resolve the weapons standoff.
New Zealand's Prime Minister Jenny Shipley has completed her first Australian tour in the midst of a row over defence funding. But after a successful meeting with Australian Prime Minister John Howard, the two leaders announced their intention to try to revive the Anzac spirit through a joint effort in the Gulf.
The first visit to Australia by New Zealand's first woman Prime Minister, almost derailed by these comments from General John Baker.
I do have a concern again for the long-term rundown of New Zealand defence capabilities and their ability to pull their weight.
On arrival, Jenny Shipley was fighting back.
I would be very concerned if there was any question raised over the competence of the New Zealand Defence Force.
But by the time Prime Minister John Howard had calmed the waters, there were compliments all round.
Could I just take the opportunity of saying that as the Prime Minister of Australia, that the personal competence and the fighting capacity of the New Zealand Defence Forces is something that Australians have long admired.
Then this announcement backed by the Australian side.
It is our hope that we will be able to work as an Anzac force. New Zealanders and Australians have had a great history of being extremely successful, and I'm pleased to say that our defence people are working through to see if that is actually possible.
The most significant point about today's announcement of the Anzac Force is that there are no details, no indications of who would lead it, nor how it would be run. Both leaders say that will be worked out in coming days.
Jenny Shipley was also in town to promote New Zealand and her image as a tough economic reformer, telling her business audience her coalition government is holding firm. She promised cuts to welfare and greater workplace reform.
The Chief of Australia's Defence Forces has toned down his concerns about stability in Indonesia. General John Baker says the current turmoil could harm regional security. Comments greeted coldly by Indonesian officials. But after high-level talks in Jakarta, the General now says he's fairly confident about current conditions.
General John Baker is in Jakarta to talk to his Indonesian counterparts about the biggest crisis they've faced in 30 years. Before arriving, the Australian Defence Chief expressed his concerns about Indonesia's ability to cope with the crisis and the impact that could have on regional stability. Those remarks were seen in some senior circles here as intrusive.
It will be viewed as a little bit intruding to our domestic problems.
Today, General Baker's tone was more upbeat. He now says he's fairly confident with what he's seen.
It's important, I think, that Indonesia gets through this stage, and it's important that you come and see for yourself, and I'm glad I did.
But as Indonesia's new armed forces chief, General Wiranto, was being sworn in today, areas of the country were still in the grip of rioting. The riots had been sparked by the soaring cost of living. Officials have now warned that people found guilty of hoarding basic goods could face the death penalty. And the military says it's ready to put down any unrest.
I think, in our history, we have always prevailed. We will not fail our people, I think.
Despite the government's reassurances, outbreaks of rioting will continue to cause anxiety among Indonesia's neighbours. As this country's economic crisis deepens, far from diminishing, the unrest is expected to spread.
Authorities in Taiwan have faced a wave of public anger from critics, claiming the handling of the country's worst air crash has been slow, sloppy, and disorganized. And there's also anger from relatives for the way the airline handled the bodies of the dead and their insensitivity to grieving relatives.
Monday's crash was a severe blow to China Airlines, already struggling to improve its safety record after a spate of air disasters. More than 200 people were killed when the plane crashed at Taipei Airport on Monday. 5 days later, the bodies of the dead are still in a makeshift morgue. Grieving relatives say the corpses are not being treated with respect. This man accuses officials of letting his son's body rot in the heat. The airline is having trouble identifying the bodies. Many have been badly burned and can only be traced through DNA tests. This mourner says officials are afraid people might take the wrong body home. Criticism of the handling of the accident has come from newspapers and even the government. A senior government official says the communication and transport departments should put more work into the investigation to prevent future disasters. French aviation experts have flown in to help with the investigation. US aircraft giant Boeing has also stepped in to support Asian airlines, saying one crash doesn't mean the whole industry should be penalised.
Security forces of the Sri Lankan government have recaptured part of two strategic northern towns overrun recently by Tamil Tiger separatists. The Tigers made their gains in a fierce attack during celebrations to mark 50 years of independence.
The name of the government's military offensive, Operation Victory Assured, has an optimistic ring. Involving 20,000 troops, it's a bid to take control of a 76-kilometre stretch of highway which links Vavunya and Kilinochi. The highway is controlled by Tamil guerrillas. At the military command headquarters, the Sri Lankan army prepares for more fighting and possibly the bloodiest phase in the biggest and the costliest military campaign so far. Their immediate aim is to take Mun Kulam, a key town on the highway fiercely defended by the Tamils. The highway is a crucial link for security forces. It provides a land route to the northern Jaffna Peninsula. At present, Jaffna and its 500,000 people are supplied by costly and dangerous sea links. Capturing the highway would also restrict the Tigers. The highway battle has taken the lives of 3,200 rebels and 937 government soldiers. Unofficial estimates put military losses several hundred higher.
The trial of the man overthrown in last year's coup in Cambodia will take place next month, with or without him. A Phnom Penh court has ordered exiled Prince Norodom Ranariddh to appear, together with his military commander, General Nek Bun Chai, but neither are likely to turn up.
General Nek Bun Chai, constantly surrounded by a bodyguard unit, is the man in charge of Cambodia's royalist guerrilla forces, supporters of the ousted prince. An effective jungle fighter, the general has frustrated government efforts to stop him for more than 6 months. The general directs 8,000 troops, he says, are holding the high ground. And he claims to have a total of more than 26,000 troops inside Cambodia. Fighting's been heavy, with part of his base demolished and the camp razed by tank fire. But recent guerrilla strikes, many by Khmer Rouge forces, have eased the pressure. The Khmer Rouge are fighting beside Nek Bun Chai in a controversial partnership which other national leaders want to see broken as part of a Japanese peace plan that's been put to Prince Ranariddh. The general doesn't see a problem. He says there's no formal pact with the Khmer Rouge, so there's nothing to break. All he wants is peace and a return to Phnom Penh, but that depends on the United Nations and political and military agreements. In the meantime, General Nek Bun Chai plans a possible escalation of the war, keeping up the pressure on his enemies and reminding the world that resistance to the coup goes on.
The Japanese government has been rocked by the suicide of a politician at the centre of a bribery scandal. Shokei Ari, a member of Japan's ruling party, hanged himself in a hotel room as police were preparing to arrest him. The MP and former bureaucrat with the Ministry of Finance has been accused of accepting thousands of dollars from Nikko Securities. The influential finance ministry is currently under investigation for graft. And still in Japan, a timely reminder of the cost of global conflict. Former prisoners of war have told a Tokyo court how they suffered at the hands of their Japanese captors. The men are part of a class action demanding an official apology and financial compensation from the Japanese government.
The former prisoners of war are no strangers to the Tokyo courts. They've been here five times before to pursue their case for compensation. But this was their last chance to describe to the judges how they suffered in Japanese labour camps. Arthur Titherington told the court that he lived each day in fear of death, At one point, he broke down in tears as he explained how he and other prisoners were constantly beaten.
I think you'd have to have a heart of stone not to have been moved.
If there is any justice in Japan, then we've won. I really do feel that if that didn't get the judge to see what a moral issue this is.
Last month in Tokyo, the Japanese Prime Minister, Yutaro Hashimoto, and Tony Blair announced some new gestures of reconciliation. It was an effort to pave the way for the Japanese Emperor's visit to Britain in May. But Japan is adamant compensation is not on offer.
Our position on this is very clear, that we have proffered our very sincere apology, and it should be accepted as such.
The survivors have threatened to disrupt the Emperor's visit to make their demands known.
We are the forgotten people. The world doesn't know, the world doesn't care.
The outcome of this case probably won't be known until after the Emperor has visited Britain. But the survivors say even if they don't succeed this time, they'll appeal and appeal again, all the way to the Supreme Court.
And to the United States, where Americans are still dealing with the pain of World War II. Across the nation, people commemorated the hundreds of thousands of Japanese Americans imprisoned by the government during the war. Victims of the internment have been urging Americans to honour those who lived through the horror.
Regarded as enemy aliens, a potential enemy within, Japanese Americans were taken from their homes and forced to live in internment camps while the United States fought a brutal war with Japan. Between 1942 and 1945, the American government forced more than 120,000 Japanese Americans from their homes, schools and jobs. They were moved into internment camps under the watch of armed guards, victims of a climate of fear among Americans who believed they were Japanese spies. Not a single incident of espionage or treason was ever proven against a Japanese American, but that didn't stop the internments. Survivors of the ordeal say that although it was a dark period in United States history, it's a time that shouldn't be forgotten.
Because it's a moment in American history that all of us must remember so that we don't repeat the past.
Japanese Americans suffered greatly in the camps. Many of the imprisoned lost sons who were killed in the war fighting on the American side. Reparation for the wrongs came eventually, but by that time more than 40 years had passed and many of those imprisoned had died, yet others are able to forgive.
I am very proud to be an American of Japanese ancestry, to realize that my community of Japanese Americans were betrayed by their government, but they did not betray their government.
It was only in 1988 that President Ronald Reagan and the American Congress passed a bill providing for an apology and redress to internees still living.
Turning to finance now, and Chinese economic czar Zhu Rongji is expected to back Hong Kong's decision to keep the local currency pegged to the US dollar. The Vice Premier will praise Hong Kong for warding off speculators. The territory has not been dragged down by the currency crisis which hit much of the region. The backing of China's most senior finance official is expected to boost confidence in Hong Kong. Zhu supports the territory's right to keep a capitalist lifestyle without mainland interference. And continuing today's finance news, Tokyo shares closed the day 1% firmer, the Nikkei up 140 points, buoyed by late buying. Despite Moody's Investors Service downgrading Hong Kong's credit rating, the territory's Hang Seng Index gained 19 points. Singapore's SDI Index lost 0.5%, as did the Australian market, due to uncertainty over Iraq and falls on some regional markets, the All Ordinaries shedding 14 points. The Aussie dollar also dipped, as did Hong Kong gold and Australian bullion. China's architect of reform, Deng Xiaoping, died a year ago. But in Beijing, the Chinese leadership has been marking it in a very low-key way. Instead, more attention is being paid to the 100th anniversary of another prominent communist, Zhou Enlai.
Deng Xiaoping's death 12 months ago revealed an outpouring of respect. But even then, it was clear that after 20 years of capitalism, China's urbanites prefer worshipping money rather than bygone heroes.
The Chinese masses don't pay any attention to who is the leader, but only to what makes the masses richer.
The Chinese leadership ordered a low-key remembrance on the first anniversary of Deng's death. The third generation must keep his spirit of reform alive, but must be seen to have its own identity.
Local cinemas are screening a 90-minute documentary on Deng's life, one that projects a softer image. This film has never been seen by the public before. Deng, the gentle grandparent, and a grieving son caressing his dead father's cheek.
Italy's Deborah Compagnoni today became the first alpine skier to win gold at three Olympics. She successfully retained the women's giant slalom crown in Nagano to claim a unique place in the record books.
Compagnoni had led after the first leg, just as she had in yesterday's slalom, before losing by 0.6 overall to Germany's Hilda Gerg and settling for the silver. Today, though, she made no mistakes in her two runs on the treacherous course. The second leg was brought forward 45 minutes due to deteriorating weather conditions. It started to rain during the first leg and continued during the second. But for Compagnoni, the conditions simply allowed her to demonstrate her consummate skills.
And stops the clock in the very, very impressive time, 118.94.
In the four-man bobsleigh, the Australians had the worst of the conditions. They started 24th down the spiral, and with heavy rain falling and a chopped-up course, they did remarkably well to finish in 21st position after the first run.
A little bump on the wall there. Oh, he's put it sideways. That's unfortunate for Jason. It's very difficult to try and drive in these conditions.
They're the Oscars of the fashion world. The Council of the Fashion Designers of America has selected the world's best designers for 1997 at a glitzy New York gala.
For the first time in years, the CFDA staged a fashion show. John Galliano's spring-summer haute couture collection that he showed in Paris in January. Galliano won the international award.
Never in my wildest dreams did I imagine I would be up here tonight.
The stars of fashion and Hollywood came out to light up the night. Bill Blass, Vivian Tam, Michael Kors, from stage and screen Sigourney Weaver, Hugh Grant and Elizabeth Hurley, Raquel Welch, Eartha Kitt and Rupert Everett. But no star shone brighter than Elizabeth Taylor. She also changed. She let her hair go white. Taylor received an overwhelming ovation. Demi Moore presented her with the award for a lifetime of glamour.
I just love the irony of the fact that I have been on every worst list ever compiled.
Marc Jacobs was presented the Women's Wear Designer of the Year from his friend, model Kirsten Owen. Accessory Designer of the Year went to Kate Spade. This is the second time in 5 years that Spade has won for her handbags. The Perry Ellis Awards go to young designers. And for women's wear, it was Narciso Rodriguez who took home the prize.
What can you say that tops Elizabeth Taylor?
Ralph Lauren received an award for his humanitarian leadership. First Lady Hillary Rodham Clinton made a tape for the presentation.
We are all grateful to you for your leadership and the many things you do to make our country a better place.
That's the 1997 CFDA Awards.
And before we go, let's take a look at the weather for the start of the weekend. And cold and sunny in Seoul, Tokyo and Taipei showers, Hong Kong rain, fine for Hanoi and cloud in Beijing and Shanghai. Bombay sunny and 31, Dakar showers, Colombo cloudy, Rangoon fine and haze expected in New Delhi and Bangkok. Jakarta afternoon storms and 32 for a top, showers on the islands and in Singapore and fine elsewhere. Fine too across most of the region apart from showers in Hobart, storms in Darwin and Honiara and showers for Suva and Namur. And that's the news from Australia Television for the moment. I'm Rosemary Church. Enjoy your weekend. Good night.
This week on Recovery, we've got The Living End.
Sidewinder. Nancy Vandal, Kate Sobrano, we talked to the star of indie flick All Over Me, Alison Follin, and we've also got celebrity impersonator and funny man Thomas Bromhead. That's this Saturday on Recovery, 9 till 12.
A beautiful bunch, a ripe banana.
Daylight come and we wander home.
Hide the deadly black tarantula.
Daylight come and we wander home.
Live
6 foot, 7 foot, 8 foot.
Banana.
The following edition of Rage is rated M for mature audiences. It contains adult themes, coarse language, sexual references, and drug references. After 6 a.m., Rage is for general viewing.
Yeah.